is a descendant of Turtle Mountain, is a renowned international speaker, author, and digital creator who is known for his social media series, Ojibwe Word of the Day. Please go check it out. James Keene insights were developed through speaking with and recording elders and native language speakers across North America as part of the Ojibwe Language Dictionary Project. He's a passionate advocate for sharing how to live life and live the good life. For 20 years, he's facilitated community language tables, consulted with public-private organizations on language and cultural programs, and traveled internationally as a keynote speaker. He's been featured in numerous publications, podcasts, radio, and television. We are so fortunate to have James and his family here in the Twin Cities and here for the first time at Lake Harriet Spiritual Community. Please welcome James Vukelich. Oh.
Aho, bonjour, in the Noi Maganadok. Arnin, Kage Gabo and Dishinikas, Mikanak and Dudem, Mikanak Wajawing and Dunjaba, Besho Gakabakang and Danungum, Engichi Mikwech Awendum, Jayayan O Omanungum, Mikwech Bejayig, Mikwech Bezendayig, Engajaganashim Gaye. So I will also speak a little English. And what I said there was a traditional Ojibwe protocol greeting. I said, hello, all of my relatives. My name is Kage Gabo. I'm also James Vukelich. I'm Turtle Clan. I'm a descendant of Turtle Mountain. I live close to Gakabakong, the place of the falls, Minneapolis. And I'm incredibly delighted to be here, and I wanted to thank you all for coming out this morning and listening and being here. This is a very special moment for me. 13 years ago, I was going through a profound transformation. I had quit smoking cigarettes, and I would, in my meantime, drive around the parkway. And I had happened upon this place by accident on a couple of different occasions. And I thought, it is the most beautiful building. It was mysterious to me, and to finally venture, ask, and then be invited to speak here with you all, it's a privilege, it's a pleasure, and it's kind of a full circle moment. So, what had started part of that spiritual transformation for me was learning about this concept of seven generations and learning about it in the language. This was once a petroglyph. It comes from the word petro, stone, and glyph, to write. It was moved to a wigwasabak, a birch bark scroll, which is how we traditionally carried knowledge in the Anishinaabe nation, and today we're using PowerPoint on a presenter, and it's being live streamed. So our media has changed a little bit, but our message is still the same. And if we look at this first generation, we see Nin, that's I, me, myself. Our next generation is Nus, my father, and Ninga, my mother. These are the very old words to say my father and my mother in the language. Our next generation is Nimishomis, my grandfather, and here's one that probably, if you're a Minnepolitan or from the Twin Cities, will recognize right away, Nokomis. Nokomis. I know we pronounce it Nokomis in English, but Nokomis is a very ancient word. And I think we can make a scientific case that whenever we talk about Lake Nokomis, we use that first part, Noko, we are using a sound that dates back to prior to the ending of the last ice age. It means where we are at now. When this was a mountain of ice a mile high, there were people who saw woolly mammoths, they saw giant moose, they saw saber-toothed tigers, they saw Missimic, a giant beaver. And when I say giant, they were about the size of Mukwa, a black bear. If you can imagine Mukwa at that time. On his hind feet, he stood 11 to 12 feet tall. I'm 6'3". If you can imagine sticking another of me on top of myself, you get an idea of how big some of the megafauna were. And there was someone who saw a mountain of ice before Gichigami, the great sea of the Anishinaabe, Lake Superior, existed. They saw these magnificent megafauna, and they used that sound, Noko, to talk about my grandmother. Now, and I love to share that with people because so often our history begins with with contact. And that's a very important part of our history. But it's really a drop in the bucket. It's something that goes back thousands upon thousands of years. And then we have our next generation, Indonaco Bitchigan. And that can mean my great-grandparent, but it doesn't just mean that. It has in it this small word part. It's a morpheme. It's the smallest part of a word that carries meaning. When I began learning the language as a 25-year-old man, I didn't hear the language growing up. My mother went to a boarding school. My grandmother went to a residential school. They were taken away from their homes. They were separated from their language, their culture, their history, their spirituality. And when I had an opportunity to begin learning the language as a 25-year-old, I became absolutely fascinated with it. I went all in. I took a degree at University of Minnesota. I had a chance to teach the grammar and the structure of the language. And when I went back to school, I studied linguistics. It's a scientific study of language. And as I was recording elders for the dictionary project, the Ojibwe People's Dictionary that you can see online, I noted that each of these words was telling a story when the elders were breaking down the words and saying what each one of them meant. This one absolutely fascinated me because it shows up in so many words. There's Anekanutage, and I've already done that this morning. It's to translate. It's to say a word in one language and then repeat that in the target language of your audience. There's Aneke Ogamakwe. There's that Anek again. This could be a vice president, a vice chief, a lieutenant governor. The Kwe suffix means I'm speaking about a woman. This could be Vice President Harris or Lieutenant Governor Peggy Flanagan, who's the first Anishinaabe Kwe to hold that position in our state. And then there's Anek Obidun. I don't know if we have people who quilt, thread, crochet. When you've run out of thread and you tie another piece of thread to it, you've made both of those pieces one. You've interconnected them. You've interlinked them. When I asked one elder, what does that word mean to you? He thought about it pensively for a moment. He was really dragging it out, stroking his chin, thinking about it. He looked at me. He knew I had a Western education, a Western background, and said it's a lot like a bike chain. For him, this anek is to happen in a sequence. It's to be linked. For him, this was my great-grandparents, my parents, my great-grandparents, my grandparents, my parents, and myself were interlinked. So if we were to spiritually, or if we were to just translate this word, and if you look this up in the Ojibwe People's Dictionary, you'll see it can mean my great-grandparents, my great-grandfather, my great-grandmother. Indonaco Bitchigan can also mean my ancestor. That person I was speaking about 13,000 years ago, I can call him or her Indonaco Bitchigan. But if we were to spiritually interpret this word, it would mean that being I'm inextricably interconnected to. That being I'm inextricably linked to. And in the Ojibwe language, it's also a word for my great-grandchild. I call him or her Indonaco Bitchigan. This is a picture of this fellow almost 9 years ago and my grandmother. Here we have four generations. Two people that call each other Indonaco Bitchigan. So if we look at this holistically, if it works going up, it should work going down. This would be Neen. I, me, myself, Ngosis, my son, Indonis, my daughter, Nujisheyug, my grandchildren, and then Indonaco Bitchigan. And they call me Indonaco Bitchigan, my great-grandchild, my great-grandparent. So if we look at this holistically and logically, with one word, we have an implication of seven generations. Seven generations, past, present, and future, that are punctuated intergenerationally by this concept of I'm inextricably interconnected to you. I'm inextricably linked to you. And whatever is going to affect me will affect you. The first time this made sense, it brought up a number of teachings that take place both spiritually and scientifically. One of the spiritual teachings that came to mind immediately was the law of karma. Often we'll mistake this as the law of cause and effect. When you look at it, it's an ancient Sanskrit word. It has in its root word kri, which is your action, your deed. So you can develop good karma. You've acted altruistically with kindness, with benevolence. That is what will come back to you. You may also have bad karma. Maybe you've been mischievous or even malevolent. And that is what will return to you. This will show up in so many Eastern Asian faiths. In Middle Eastern spiritual traditions, particularly the New Testament, this will become, you will reap what you sow. Whatever seed you put in the ground, that is the plant you should expect to grow. Jesus may be more explicit about this when he states that if you take up the sword, you will perish by the sword. Your actions will have a reaction. From an Ojibwe perspective, your actions will have a reaction that will echo through the generations. So the law of science, where a reaction is going to be an opposite and equal reaction. And as we are learning today, the study of epigenetics, and when the first time I saw a double helix, a strand of DNA, I saw links in a chain. And I thought of that word, Indonico Bichigan, to be interconnected, to be interlinked. And I realized that there were good reasons why I didn't have a chance to learn the language. My parents, or my mother, my grandmother, were in residential schools and boarding schools. They were in an atmosphere that was oppressive, in which, if I think of my great-grandfather's example, who was born 100 years before me, he could go to jail for introducing himself in the language and having sweet grass with him. He would lose his family structure. In fact, he couldn't leave the reservation unless if he had express written consent from the Indian agent. So we understand that our actions will echo through the generation, that we have through our DNA the potential to pass on trauma intergenerationally, as well as strength and resilience. So the first time I saw this, I got really excited because finally it had made sense. And in the indigenous community, you hear about seven generations all the time. It is in our mandates. It is in our mission statements. There are even educational institutions called Seven Generations. And as I was walking into a class in South Minneapolis at Center School, an American Indian magnet school, there was an elder who asked, do you understand this concept of seven generations? I'm like, yeah, I've heard of it. Like every indigenous person, and he pointed out, it's very simple, young man. It's all in the language. And I had realized that, I didn't even need to translate seven generations. They handled it with one word, with one relative term, the degree of elegance and sophistication. And he pointed out that when he was growing up in the Lake of the Woods area, there are a number of Gete Anishinaabe, old-time indigenous people, people who were born in lodges, who lived on trap lines. And he said when they reached a certain age, they would try to avoid using that word, neen, I, me, myself, in conversation. Now, I was a little confused. It has a perfect linguistic function, kind of differentiate my perspective from yours, ours, his, hers, theirs. But when I translated this word, neen, into Latin, I bet you all recognize that. Ego, ego. And I think by example, they were trying to say that this idea of ego, this idea of this I, me, myself, it might be an illusion. For them, they were a link in the chain going all the way back and going all the way forward. I am all of my relatives. And all of my relatives are me. Their spiritual teaching was only Kije Manadu, only the kind spirit, the benevolent mystery. The creator can say I, excluding you. Human beings can't. They would say I am all of my relatives, and all of my relatives are me. Now, that was like this light bulb moment for me. It clicked, it made sense. And it was this joy because I had figured it out. I had figured it out through the perspective of the language. And then that joy was replaced with this awesome sense of responsibility. It was the birth of responsibility for me. I had at this moment scientific and spiritual proof that every single one of my choices, actions, and decisions, and not just me, if you are in this audience listening, if you are online, every single thing we do has the potential to affect someone we'll never see, we'll never speak to, listen to, or hold. Every single thing we do has the potential to affect someone seven generations from now. So my question was no longer, why am I here? Maybe that question of existential teenage angst we will all ask at one point or be asked, why am I here? Why was I born? I didn't ask for this. The culture had answered it for me. We're here because we're related. So it was no longer, why am I here? It became how. How do I live in a way that I can bring peace and balance to all of my relatives? How can I live without conflict with my ecosystem, with my environment, or my relatives? How can I lead a holistic life? A life where my actions are in alignment with my words. Life without contradiction. People all over the world have asked this question. And it's wonderful. From my vantage point, I'm seeing examples of some of the images I'll show in a moment. This is Mahavira. In the Jain faith, he had found moksha, mukti, liberation from that cycle of karma that kept him reincarnating lifetime after lifetime. For the Buddha, in his language, Pali, it was nibbana. Later, in the language of the priests, in Sanskrit, it'll become nirvana. He had put out the flames of desire. He wasn't always reaching for it. He wasn't always grabbing for it. He had found peace. Lao Tzu and his contemporaries lived in accordance with the Tao. They went along with the natural flow of the universe. Jesus found the kingdom of God within himself, that divine spark. Socrates spoke of leading the examined life. For him, the unexamined life wasn't worth living. And our ancestors spoke of Minopamatsuan, the good life, a life of peace, a life of balance, a life without conflict or contradiction. And they left us a way to do that. The Gichi Dabak Konage went on. The great law, the sacred law. In that word, there's Gichi, great. Dib is to measure, to speak about. Akon is a wood-like article in the hand. Maybe a brief aside. When I've said this in communities where there are a number of fluent first language speakers, some of them will kind of laugh at this point. A modern translation of Dabak Konage is a judge. What they're speaking about, what they're measuring, is a ruling, a sentence, the wood-like article, it's a gavel. So these were people who obviously had run-ins with the law at one point in their life and had a fond memory of speaking to the Dabak Konage Winini, Dabak Konage Wikwe. But if we look at a traditional perspective of this, what they are speaking about here, is the Okij. It's the pipe stem. It's part of the Opwagan. It's part of the sacred pipe. They have a gift for us to pray with, to give thanks, to make relationships. Means what we're about to discuss is something that has been meditated upon and mediated with the four sacred medicines: sage, sweetgrass, gijik, cedar, and of course the sema, tobacco. And we also call these, oh, there it goes. Maybe you've heard of this called a peace pipe. Often when we made relationships with different nations and created peace, this was a promise in front of all of our relatives, in front of the whole universe, that what we were saying was true and that what we were, our actions after that would be in alignment with what we were saying. We also call these the seven grandfather teachings. And I think to really understand these, my perspective became, well, I understood the linguistics, having studied linguistics in grad school, but I also had to look at the culture, the spirituality, and the ceremony of our ancestors. And one of the most ancient ceremonies I found is called Gi Egoshimoin, vision quest. And maybe you've heard that term before. I found an account that was written in 1904, completely in Ojibwe, by the late Chief John Benesi, Kakike Benesiban. And he was an old man in 1904. This must have taken place in the 1830s or 1840s. And he recalled being woken up by his father one morning in the lodge. He lived in a Waginogon, and Dad woke him up. He used that old word for my father, noose. Noose woke me up. And as this boy woke up, he looked at his father, who had two birch bark dishes. In one was mijim, food, manomen, wild rice, mandamen, corn, minan, berries, wiyas, venison, and in the other was a kokanje, So he knows at this moment he's being presented a choice, and there's an incredibly important spiritual teaching taking place here. No one can make you do it. No one can do it for you. If you choose to do this ceremony, it has to be your own choice. And grandma and grandpa can't do this for you. Your cousins, your uncles, they can't. It has to be you. So, if he chooses breakfast, he would have been fed, but he knew. And he picked the akakange. The old man picked up the charred piece of wood in Makadeke. He blackened his face with it, marked his face with it several times. And for the next 4 days and three nights, this boy, maybe slightly older than my son, went on a mountain in isolation without food and water to seek out a dream, to seek out a vision. For me, this scene is always in The Matrix, when Neo meets Morpheus, and he says, you have to pick it. It has to be the red pill or the blue pill. So at the end of this first day, as the sun is going down, this boy, who is hungry, he is thirsty, he's lonely. If you're ever by Lake Superior, as the sun's going down, you start to get cold. I wonder what's going through his mind. I bet he's asking himself, if I were to get water right now, how would I do that? How would I get some food? How would I get shelter? How would I even start a fire? And he's learning something very important. What happens to a human being without food, water, clothing, or shelter? You will die. You will die. He is learning this incredibly important teaching in real time. For the rest of his life, if he meets someone without those basic core human needs being met, he will feel a real, genuine, authentic empathy for them. I too have faced hunger, thirst, cold, and loneliness. And if I can, I will help you. You know, we recently celebrated Thanksgiving. As an indigenous person, I've been asked often, well, why did they help those people? It was because it was embedded in our spirituality. It was embedded in our ceremony. This is how you should treat your fellow human being. And if you're a boy in the 1830s or 1840s, where does your food, water, clothing, and medicine come from? It all comes from the earth. If you're an Anishinaabe person in the 1830s, he's learning Dabasendizawin, humility right now. As he realizes, in order for me to have makizanun, shoes, moccasins, clothing, these are coming from the four-legged. The Wawashkeshi, the deer, moose, the moose, a dick, the caribou, they're feeding us, they're clothing us. The Giguiug, the swimmers, the fish, they're feeding us. The Benashiug, the birds. The Mushkiki, the medicine. I love this name for medicine in Ojibwe. It has in it mushk, strength, and aki, the earth. It's the strength of the earth. When we need to be nourished, when we need to be healed, we seek out the strength of the earth. And when they're saying Dabasendizil in Ojibwe, they're saying, I think lowly of myself. That word has in it, Dabas, though, ain is to think, and Dizo is of myself. I think lowly of myself. I am not more important than the relatives who are giving me life. In fact, I cannot live without you. And now they are all relatives, all of the four-leggeds, all of the trees, all of the plants, the water, because I have a relationship with them. It is that relationship that makes them relatives. So when you begin a prayer with Ndinawe Maganadok, all of my relatives, you're addressing everyone in the east, south, west, and north, the entire universe. I have a relationship with all of you, and I am not more important than you. And that word has an manachi itiwan, respect. It's to go easy on. It's to use sparingly. For me, until I looked at this word in Ojibwe, respect was almost like an acknowledgement of someone's authority. For this is an acknowledgement of relationship, of affection, of care. The moment this boy realizes, I will have to hunt, I will have to harvest, and after I do that, these beings will no longer be alive in order for me to survive. I will take only what I need, and I will leave the rest behind. This is a reciprocal verb. It means they do it to each other. I told you earlier, my family is from Turtle Mountain, They were a buffalo people. The buffalo took very good care of us. They fed us, they clothed us, they gave us shelter, they gave us a myriad of tools. So if you ask yourself, is it a good idea then to go out and kill the buffalo, or is that catastrophically stupid? You would realize you went easy on them. You took only what you need. But because this is reciprocal, the buffalo, Mashkore Bishiki, looked at us and said, if we do not feed, clothe, and shelter our younger sibling, they're not going to survive. They will die. For me, part of respect is to acknowledge the sanctity of my relatives' lives, to acknowledge the sacredness of their lives. And a boy like this asking himself, well, who else in my life feeds me, clothes me, gives me shelter, gives me medicine when I'm sick? My parents, my relatives. Why do they do that? Because they love us. Saki ittiwin is our Ojibwe word for love. It has in it this beautiful morpheme, zog, which is to emerge, it's to arise. This is a friend of mine's Ojibwe name, Sagachiwe. That zog is to emerge and aju is behind the mountain. So it could be someone walking on top of a hill. When they reach the summit, they come into view. I hope this shall come through, because this is exactly what this boy would see at the end of his first night of fasting. I've had a chance to stand here. This is Thunderbird Mountain. It's overlooking Thunder Bay. And in a moment, we're going to see Sagachiwe. The person coming from behind the mountain, it's Gimishomasanon. It's our grandfather. It's the sun. And I know in this month we're speaking about the light. Now when the light of the sun shines in the morning, when Gimishomasanon shines upon all of us, who is the sun shining on? Everyone and everything. What we're seeing here is an Ojibwe perspective of what does Kijemana do? What does the kind spirit, the benevolent mystery, the Creator's love look like? And it has to be something unconditional. It has to be something for everyone and everything. And if you've ever spent a night out camping, especially this boy who is alone, who is thirsty, who has made it through that first night, and the sun rises, it is a glorious moment. And the idea that the way that the light is shining on him is a way that he can shine on other people. For him, this was Zagi Ittiwin. It's love. In Ojibwe, our name for May is the Zagi Bagagizes. Again, there's that Zug to emerge. Bug is a leaf. It's the budding moon. And as Minnesotans, we know that in May, as the days begin to get warmer, they get longer. The thunderbirds fly overhead, there are rainstorms. And one afternoon, you're walking along the boulevards of Minneapolis and all of a sudden, life is emerging from the trees, from these once bare branches. This is mandamin, corn, the wonder seed. And as the days have become warmer, after the rains have poured, all of a sudden, life emerges, zog. Zagi Baga. Now when this corn comes to fruition, the corn will feed a thief or a teacher, a saint or a sinner. We're seeing how the mushkiki, how the strength of the earth, our food can show us unconditional love. And we don't just have one word to say love in Ojibwe. There are two. There's more. Shuwainam, it's to have compassion for. It's to bless. It's to love unconditionally. I'd like to share with you the name for February. In Ojibwe, it's the Name Benigizis, it's the suckerfish moon. Now, as Minnesotans, we know February can get awfully cold. And like last winter, we had a proper winter. It was began with a polar vortex, snow, more snow, another polar vortex, and by February, food stores had run out. People were becoming bakude. Nowadays, that means I'm hungry, but back then it meant I'm gaunt from hunger. My skin is getting gray. The effects of starvation are beginning to show on my body. And so they did what they were instructed to do at these times. when it gets very cold and the animals will burrow in for a month. They ask for help. And it's said there's a man who has a vision where Namabin, the suckerfish, approaches him in his dream and tells him that if you set your nets underneath the ice, we will swim into them. When it gets that cold, most fish will go towards the bottoms of lakes and rivers. The bottom dwellers, however, will go towards the ice. He wakes up. They do this the next morning. They have a network of holes that they feed their nets through. And it's Namabin. It's the suckerfish who looks at Anishinaabe, and in a perfect translation of this word that we can't get maybe linguistically, we see it through action. Has compassion for us. Has pity on human beings who are about to perish. Shows us unconditional love with their bodies, with their lives, and blesses us with life. This is Tijuwenum. At the end of ceremony, you'll hear Shawena Mishanom, Shawena Mishanom, Shawena Mishanom, Shawena Mishanom. Please bless, please have compassion, please love all of us unconditionally, and it's all of us. It's all of my relatives. It was usually poor form to pray exclusively for yourself in indigenous spirituality. You would ask for your relative the same thing you would ask for yourself, knowing that if it's good for my relative, it will be good for me. If I truly believe, I will want for that relative the same thing I want for myself. I've made it a point after the pandemic that if there's someone in your life who you truly feel this way for, and you want to tell them that I love you in Ojibwe, you can always say, Gizagi'in, I love you. Or Gizhuwenamin, Gimikwenamina. This is what we say every morning when I drop them off at school. Gigawabmin, we don't have a word for goodbye. Gigawabmin, Gizhuwenamin, I'll see you later. I love you. We'll say it to one another, but now I have to say it before he opens up the door to go to school, unless of the people here. I look forward to those mornings. And remember that if you are all of your relatives and all of your relatives are you, you are just as deserving of this love as your relatives are. Don't forget to love yourself. And Zungide Ewen, strength, courage, bravery. There's a story I want to share with you about the very land we are on. A story that radically transformed the way I look at courage. Begins in the early 1860s. There's a Dakota, a Bwan village, that is attacked by the Chamokoman, by the Americans. Chamokoman, it means long knife. It's a reference to the bayonets at the end of the soldiers' rifles. And they arrive there to decimate the village, to destroy it. There's a woman who hides for her life in a nearby swamp. Wiaka Shintemi, tail feather woman. And while she's hiding, she's even hiding underwater at times, using a hollow reed to breathe through. If she is discovered, she will be killed on sight. They're not there to take prisoners. They are there to destroy, to annihilate the village. And while she is hiding for her life, she has a vision. She's hiding for 3 to 4 days. Or Wakantanka, where the great mystery, the great spirit tells her that the spirit is very disappointed in how human beings are living. There's a great deal of warfare at the time. The Civil War has ended. The wars for the Great Plains are raging. And the Dakota aren't just fighting the Americans, they are involved in a war with the Ojibwe. And this war has been going on for maybe 100 winters, maybe 200 winters. We don't know, but we know that there had not been peace between both of these nations. And she's told that if the Dakota were to present a drum to the Anishinaabe, it would bring peace to both of their nations. She escapes with her life, is shown what this drum looks like, and brings it to the nearest Dakota village where they begin at once creating the Bwanji Dewegan, the Dakota drum. And it said once it's completed, once the accoutrements, the Opwaganug, the Chanupa, the pipes, the Miigwenug, the feathers, and the songs are bundled together, they are brought to the Anishinaabe at Mississaugaginning, at Lake Mille Lacs, the original Midewakan, the original Mystic Lake. And when they sit with each other at the drum and they sound it, what they are doing is making the sound of the heart. That word, and I know you have drumming here, in Ojibwe, that word dewe egun has in it de, the heart. We is to speak, and egun, it's the instrument, it's the tool, it's the instrument that makes the sound of the heart. And when they sounded it, it represented both of their hearts beating as one. When they began singing the songs, they were speaking with one voice. The smoke that was coming up from the sweetgrass, the wingushk, the bashkore jibik, the sage, the asema, the tobacco from the opwaganag, from the chinupa, from the sacred pipes, represented both of their prayers. The smoke represented both of their prayers going to the heavens. And at that moment, they said, no matter what happens, I shall never raise my hand to you again. My children shall not inherit war from me, knowing the same way that I inherited war from my parents, from my grandparents, and my great-grandparents. I will be the change maker. They will not get this from me. At that point, my idea of what it meant to be courageous, to have zungidewin, radically changed. When we say that word in Ojibwe, we're saying, you have a strong heart. Zung is strong. The de is the heart, like the dewe egun. If you tell someone you're brave in Ojibwe, you're saying, you have a strong heart. And at that point, it was no longer, I am unafraid to go and fight Dakotas. It meant, I am utterly unafraid to treat Dakotas as a relative. That takes true strength of heart. And that will show up in so many of the religions and spiritual traditions we have surrounding us as loving one's enemy. And seeing the truth of that they are actually relatives. And that those people who had brought the worst war has to offer, poverty, bereavement, terror, rage, anxiety, made that choice that I have gone through this, but my children, my grandchildren, and my great-grandchildren will not. I will show them what true strength of heart is. Debwewin, truth. One etymology I heard from the late Marlene Stately from Gazagaskwa Jamaicog, the place of many leeches, Leech Lake, Minnesota. For her, it had in it that de again, which is the heart. Way is to speak. I am speaking to you from my heart. I am speaking to you from the very center and core of my being. Maybe at some point in your life, you'll see a birch bark scroll or even a petroglyph where there's a figure with something in the middle, their heart, and a line coming through it. I am expressing myself from the very center and core of my being to you. I'm speaking the truth to you. And guaikwatazi is honesty. For me, when I learned these in English, truth and honesty, I was thrown off just a little bit. In standard North American English, these are synonymous. You're honest, you tell the truth. If you tell the truth, you're honest. And Anishinaabe Mon, it is all about how you live your life. Guaikwatazi means right, proper, correct, in order. Atsi is to live. And everyone in here at one point in your life or another will have someone who tells you you should dress a certain way, speak a certain way, look a certain way, do a particular ceremony, and then you watch them doing something completely different on a Friday or Saturday night out on the town. It's contradiction. It's hypocrisy. And Anishinaabe Mon, it's about being authentic. It is, if you really want to know if I'm being honest, observe how I live my life. The truth will invariably come out. It always does. And Nibwakawin, wisdom, intelligence. The final grandfather teaching, the final sacred law we'll speak about today. It has in it this word part, wa, which I wouldn't publish this in a paper, but it has been. I have discussed this with relatives because it, particularly elders, because of its meaning, wa, it shows up in so many of our very important, very spiritually important words. For example, it will start with wabang. Wabang. Waban is the dawn. That is, as the sun is rising, like we watched with Zagachiwe, coming over the horizon and enlightening everything. The direction that Waban shows up is Wabanong, the east. As I brought up my trusty phone. I saw that east is facing this way. If you were to face this way, Wabanong, the source of the light, the source of daylight. It'll show up in our beautiful words for Wawate, which we had a chance to see recently, the northern lights. And here, the grammar is actually being depictive. It's not just shining, it's glowing, it's radiating. Wawate. If you notice there, they don't just shine on us. And as we were looking at the, as you can see them, sometimes they look like the Jibayak Nimeetiwak, which is another way of describing that. The ghosts, the spirits are having a powwow. Wawatesi. There's that wawate with the sea makes this something spontaneous. It's a firefly. I don't know if you've ever had an opportunity, even here in Minnesota, even here in the city, to look in a field at night and all of a sudden see spontaneous intermittent illuminations in a darkened field. That wa, when we use it in wabam, to see, that can be conjugated 6,000 different ways. We're dealing with a language that has well over 6,000 different ways to describe seeing. But you absolutely need light to have sight. And I thought, and I asked myself, well, can you see? Can you see without light? And that's to have a vision, a dream, a wachige. This is why this young child went out to seek out a vision. We can see without our eyes. We can use our mind. You think about the electrical impulses that are going on. You can see little lights that are taking place. For me, wa, in this nibwa kawin, it is light. It is to be able to have vision. It is able to have sight. You are living with vision. You are living with intelligence. You are living with wisdom. You are living that if you had led a life with humility, with respect, acknowledging the sanctity of your relatives' lives, with strength of heart, with courage, with love, unconditional and for everyone, with truth and honesty, then every single one of your actions, every single one of your decisions will be something positively beneficial, not just for you, but for someone coming 7 generations from now. You will act in a way that, for me, is to be enlightened, to be able to see in the future from a vantage point that, although I shall never meet, speak to, listen to, or hold these people, how I am acting right now, according to this sacred law, will be something positively beneficial for them. I'm delighted to have had a chance to share this with you all. We have lived this way since those glaciers have been here, before the creation of Lake Superior. For me to have an opportunity to come back to this, to come to this beautiful building that I've driven by so many times, and to have this moment to speak with you all, it is a pleasure, it's a privilege, and a traditional way of ending a discourse like this would be to say, Apajigo Miigwech, Vizindawiyik. Thank you all so much for listening. Miigwech.
Thank you so much, James. Please, please do check out your website. And we're so much in gratitude to have you here for the first time and hope you'll get on the rotation, Mr. Don. Yes, James, you can, your mic is hot. Your website is jameswukulich.com. Just don't misspell it. And it brings me back to memories of capturing fireflies with my sisters. Got it by my mom and dad, and knowing that as long I can still get to First Avenue and enjoy the Lennon tribute as long as I treat everyone appropriately. And karma will not haunt me. So it's like this. Every week, we get wonderful presenters like James. We are so blessed. And let me get to the right side of this. But after offering, we are going to make a small circle, join hands, and James will send us up into our beautiful ceiling with some positive thoughts. And we do remind you that we are supported by your offerings. Everything that you give helps us turn the wrench on the boiler and keep programs going. And we do have programs going on most every day of the week, from yoga to meditations, to drumming, and I love the references to many of the things that we also do practice here, the meditation and the things. Welcome. And at this time, we're going to do a little music and have offering.
When they are home, when they are home, when they are, when they are, ho, ho, ho.
Ask you to raise your hands and repeat after me. God's perfect love flowing through me blesses and multiplies all that I give, all that I receive, and all that I am. Thank you. And now, as we like to do at Lake Harriet Spiritual Community, we're going to make a small circle around here and join hands and have some final parting words. And please do stay and engage the wonderful people that you're meeting. I want to pick James' brain on many different things, but do stay and engage.
Aho, Ingamachita. I'll begin. Ingitimi Gwech Wendam Jayayan Oomanongom, Apajigomi Gwech Bizai. I'm so grateful to be here with all of you today, and I just wanted to thank you all for being here. We know that it is a futile task to try to make someone change. It's a fool's errand. It is quite impossible. I've learned this myself. What part of the reason why I was driving by here when I was speaking about that 13 years ago was that I had quit smoking cigarettes after decades of using tobacco as a nicotine addict. And I needed something to do. So I was driving my car, and I realized that at that point in my life, people prior to that had been trying to get me to quit. They had been entreating me, people I loved, my beautiful wife, my brothers, my parents, friends and relatives alike. And It didn't work. It didn't work until I finally wanted to quit, until I made that decision. And when I did, it almost became effortless. I looked forward to it. But I had realized at that moment, no one could have done that. No one could have made me change. The same way I spoke of that little boy choosing to have an experience, it had to be his choice. No one could make him do it. No one could do it for him. And I realized that, well, no one can make me lead a good life. It has to be my choice. It has to be my decision. Yet, if I choose to radically change myself, if I choose to lead a life with Zagyetuwen, with love, with Debwewen, with truth, with Kwaikwatizuwen, with virtue, with righteousness, with honesty, a holistic life, a holy life where my actions are in alignment with my words, with Dabasendizuwen, with humility, where I don't exalt myself above all of my relatives, I acknowledge I am all of my relatives, with Menachietuwen, with respect, to go easy on my relatives, to acknowledge the sanctity, the sacredness of their lives, with Sungideewen, that strength of heart, that courage to make the tough decisions that I'll need to as I walk along the path of life. I know I'll act with Nebwakawen. I know I'll act intelligently, with wisdom. From an Ojibwe perspective, it would be almost to be enlightened, to be able to see things exactly as they are, without my prejudices, without that baggage I'm carrying along. And I know then that I'll be able to seek out Minopomatsuwen, a good life, a life of peace, a life of balance, a life without conflict with my environment or my relatives, a life without contradiction where I'm saying one thing and doing another. And if I radically change myself, and I am all of my relatives, and all of my relatives are me, have I in fact then changed the world? Have I changed all of my relatives if I change myself? Have I changed the way how I interact with my family and my clan? Does that change how my clan interacts with our community? Does that community change how they interact with the nation, with the world? And then I know that if I act in this positive way, it will be definitely better. It'll be positively beneficial for someone coming 7 generations from now. But I'll also have an opportunity to heal someone who may no longer be here, someone to whom I am still inextricably interconnected to. My great-grandparents, my grandparents, even one of my parents. Those people who had, you know, in my case, went through the worst of what colonization has to offer. Some of those people who did not handle trauma in a healthy way were still living their stories. We're still writing their stories. And we have, I believe, the opportunity to heal them as well. So to seek out a way of leading a life with peace and balance, past, present, and future. I'm delighted I've had a chance to share with you those grandfather teachings, the ways that I've instructed our people how to live for thousands of years. And at the closing of this wonderful meeting, again, Apichigo Migwechpizindawiek, thank you so much for having me here. And I hope that we'll all be able to walk along that path of life and seeking out a good life, a life truly worth living. Migwech, thank you.